Hello, my dears. I realized that last time. Oh, hello, my dears. That last time I made a video for you showing you all my acquisitions, jewelry acquisitions during COVID. Actually, I forgot some pieces and I've gotten some more since. So I decided that I would have fun showing them to you. Oh, I just got a package of more jewelry in the mail. Oh my god, and I can't open it while I'm here with you, I guess. Anyway, okay. So, during COVID, we're not going out, we're not eating out, we're, you know, we're not even driving anywhere. So, I'm sort of considering doing this a bit of my entertainment budget because I'm enjoying getting the stuff, I'm enjoying searching for the stuff, and I'm enjoying sharing it with you. Yes, I felt I had to justify expenses because I'm used to being very, very, very poor. I left home at 17 and was very, very, very poor. And I'm not used to having just a tiny bit of fun money. I'm just not used to it. I'm not used to having any fun money at all. Anyway, so let me get started and show you some of the really wonderful things that I've gotten. I'm going to include also a few pieces that I already own because they match what I got and that's why I got them or something like that. So. All right, I'm trying the green background because I found the white background last time made it so that you couldn't really see the colors as well and the shine as well. I've numbered all of these and I don't know why that's showing up red because it's just a pencil line. Maybe it's not red for you. What I'm doing is I'm going chronologically. So what we're starting with is Victorian jewelry, which I'm really into these days. Let's see if I can actually open this box. Oof. My husband bought them for me thinking they'd be really great organizational tools, but. Okay, this piece is, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Look how cool this is. See, now you're seeing the shine almost too much. Let's see. this is a Victorian piece, probably about 1880, 1890. It's part of what's known as the aesthetic movement. I know very little about the aesthetic movement. Basically, what I know about it is that it looks like this kind of thing. It doesn't necessarily have bugs, but it's just sort of the overall design is similar. I have another aesthetic movement piece I wanted to show you so that you could see that it doesn't have to be bugs or anything. They often have these little baubles on the edge. I don't know why. This one is very well worn. I haven't polished it yet, so it will polish up nicely like this one will. So these are both aesthetic movement. I have a feeling that they were trying to return to sort of, you know, the mass production was already a big deal, the Industrial Revolution. I have a feeling that they were trying to kind of return to more arts and crafts style of jewelry making. In fact, there was a movement called Arts and Crafts, you know, near to this time, but I'm not actually sure. I don't really know much about it. So, okay, first of all, I mean, oh, how cute is this? I'm going to take it even closer because the detail is just absolutely adorable. Look at all that little detail. I mean, how cute is that? I just love it. Now, how do I know it's Ethiopian? How do I know it's Victorian? A few ways. First of all, I just know by the style. It's silver too, by the way. First of all, I know by the style that it's Ethiopian. Oh my God, Victorian. That's the main thing. The craftsmanship, the style, etc. It's hollow. That's pretty common for the time. But looking at the back, it's very, very clear. This hinge is your biggest giveaway to Victorian. It's called a T hinge. You will sometimes see it in more recent pieces that are artisanally made, but this tube hinge is actually made by creating a tube, and then this has a little tube within it, and you sort of slot this pin into the other two tubes, and that was the way they made these at the time. If you see any other kind of hinge, you know it's at least a little bit later than that. The long pin is also a good indicator that it's very old. It could be a little newer than Victorian with the long pin, And same goes for the C-class. They fell out of favor about 1925. I mean, again, you sometimes find them, but not often. Made me more recent. I would focus, though, on the hinge. That's your number one thing. So I'm actually absolutely batty about this little thing. I'm so excited. I may end up turning it into a pendant because, you know, it's so tiny. How are you even going to notice it on clothing? Or at any rate, just seeing if I can get a jeweler to put in two little rings here, and I can just thread a chain through and wear it that way, and then also wear it as a pin if I feel like it. So, but I will get then poked from time to time, suffering for my very, very antique fashion. Anyway, I hope you're getting a really good vision of this. I'm gonna pause for a second and I will be back. Okay, so we remain in the Victorian period. Let's actually look at the back of this so that you can see what I'm talking about. Okay, again, you have your T hinge, your tube hinge. This is a maker's mark. You've got the long post, you've got the C clasp. All of these things suggest that this is Victorian. If you look at the back and the condition of the back, you can tell this is probably not gold, but it's instead what's known as gold fill. It's like a gold plate. But if you look at the front, you'd be hard pressed to know that this wasn't gold all the way through. So let's take a look at this. This is a common style called a lingerie pin. Probably worn it on your lingerie, which I still find absolutely baffling because they were all so beautiful. I've shown some other ones to you as well. It's called a Mizpah brooch. I got really interested in buying one of these. They were very common. They were often given by loved ones to each other when they were going to be parted for a while. And I ended up in a conversation with a rabbi friend of mine who is fluent in Hebrew, and I said, this has got to be related to Hebrew. Mizpah reminds me of the Hebrew word mitzvah, which is a Jewish law, or often translated as a good deed. And he said, yes, but Mizpah is a different word. It means something like watchtower. So I did a bunch of research and found out that these that Mizpah comes from a passage in the Bible that is actually, I find, a little bit troubling and disturbing. But the direct passage, take away the context of the passage, the direct passage, which I'll post up here somewhere, there, I'll make room for posting it, is something like, may the Lord watch over thee and me when we are parted, or something to that effect. So, you know, you can see why people who were parted would give it to each other. And sometimes the whole little passage would be written on one of these tiny little brooches. So, you know, after chatting with this rabbi, I just thought it was really interesting because it was not a Jewish tradition. It was very much a Christian tradition, and yet it, you know, it uses Hebrew, etc. So I just thought, wow, this would be fun. So I picked this one to own. They're not hard to find. So that's another Victorian piece that I was pretty excited to have. Now, I can't be exact about when each piece was made. This one, which was a bit of a splurge, is obviously somewhat later. It is not a tube hinge, and it is not actually exactly a C-clasp. It's a very similar kind of clasp, just not quite a C-clasp. This one was a splurge because it is, all right, we can't focus, 14 carat. Can you see that? It says 14 carat and there's a maker's mark on it. I did find the maker. I totally forget who it was. This again is probably a lingerie pin. It's probably a mourning pin. I'm thinking it's Edwardian, which is just after the Victorian period. There's your 14K mark. Mourning pins would be black for grief. They were very, very popular because Queen Victoria had been mourning the death of her husband most of her life. These are seed pearls. They're tiny, tiny little pearls. They were very popular late Victorian period through Edwardian and even a little later. And this was a real splurge. I kind of feel like maybe I shouldn't have gotten it because how am I going to wear it? I'll tell you the truth. I think it would be, if a jeweler says it's possible, I was thinking it would be really cool to make it into a ring. I don't know if it's too delicate for that or if it would cost too much. I don't know. But, well, wouldn't that make an amazing ring? So, this is pretty exciting, but not all that practical. I think this is a sort of enamel. I'm going to ask a jeweler. I don't think it's a real stone. Like, I don't think it's onyx or anything like that. Don't know. So, this is a little bit later. Let's see. What is number two? I already forget what I labeled as number two. Oh, yeah. So, I wasn't quite sure where to put these in my ordering of things, but because this is probably Victorian, maybe not, I decided to do this now, and then I'll add some stuff that's sort of thematically related, even though it was made later. Well, let's look at the back. Okay, so this is not Victorian because we can see that the pin is not a two-pinch, but again, it's around this time, or so I keep being told. They all have the C clasp. They can be fairly expensive. Oh my God, look at all this. I have three cats. This one was not all that expensive. I'm trying to get it where it doesn't have a glare on it for you. This one was quite reasonably priced, and I've never seen one like this in the yellows. You can't, there, can you see the yellow? Let me see if I can show it to you on the, oh, much better. Okay. I just thought it in the yellows was just so, I don't know, I thought it was really pretty. I've already worn it actually, even though it's COVID and I practically never go out. I wore it just sort of rolling around the neighborhood. So yeah, I usually see them in pinks and with roses, and this was different, and it was really cheap. It was under $20. I think the seller didn't realize what she had. Anyway, it's really pretty, and I really like it. And at the same time, I'm pretty sure, yeah, it was her who was also selling this, which is just, oh my goodness. Oh wow, look at it just appeared like as if by magic. These are, oh my goodness, they're so pretty. They're very similar to Mia Fiore, Mia Fiore, an Italian bead called Million Flowers, which I think I may have showed you last time. But they're not quite. My understanding is that these are actually Japanese, and they're actually called, oh, I wrote it down, Trombo or Tombo or something like that. Let me see. Yeah. Tombow beads. I don't know what that means. I'm really hoping it's not something racist. I'll look that up and see. I keep touching them because they're beautifully smooth to the touch. They're almost like sort of worry beads to touch. Again, I got this for a really good deal. It goes beautifully with this one here, which needs a bath. I'll talk to you about that in a little bit. I think it's from the 1920s. The way it's created looks 1920s to me, and the beads themselves, but I could be way off with that. I'm no expert on that. Anyway, I really like these, and they'll be so great in the summer. And yes, if they make you hungry, I'm not surprised. They look like little candies. Yeah, really like this, and I love how they came together and they go together perfectly, even though they're slightly different eras and such. Okay, so I got that at the same time. And from a different seller, I got these, which are also wonderful. They kind of look, the setting is very similar. As you can see, the way that the construction of the two is pretty much identical. Somehow to me, I feel that these are made more recently though. I don't know if that's just because they're shiny and I'm just biased or something, but as you can see, they're very similar beads. I just think they're so pretty. So they're probably also these Japanese Tombow beads. Just beautiful handmade beads. I don't know. I think they're, I don't what, I don't even really have anything to say about them except, wow, aren't they so pretty? that's about it. That's my whole story here. So, and you can see they're, you know, they're obviously very similar to these ones. I could probably wear them together. I like to wear orange a lot. It's, I don't know, makes me feel groovy, you know, like hip or something. I thought that this would be a good time to also show you these, which, oh, look at that. That is not showing you the color. Let's see if, weirdly, if I pair it with green, if it shows you the color better. Yeah, it does, actually. These are wedding cake beads. I think I mentioned them in one of my recent videos. My guess is that this particular string was made in the 1950s, but I'm not entirely sure. I don't think you're seeing how shiny they are. Let me see if I can bring them up to you and show you how shiny they are. These ones are definitely Italian. They're handmade beads, again. They're called wedding cake beads. This one is really cool because the beads are graduated in size. So the largest one is in the center. And then they graduate in size until they get so small. I've never seen wedding cake beads as tiny as this. I think they're just so cute and pretty. Some of the gold is worn off, which is to be expected given how long ago this was made. I got what I thought was a really good deal on this. I forgot to show them in my previous videos. I can't remember how much this person was selling them for. Something like $60 Canadian, which is actually a very good deal. These kinds of necklaces usually sell for well over $100 and sometimes far, far more than that, depending on how old the stones are, how good they are. These individual stones, just by themselves, unstrung, not set in anything, can sell for quite a bit on their own. So I got this just before COVID, actually, just before we went into quarantine, and I was like, yay, I can wear it, and then I couldn't wear it. So I wore it around the house a few times. So I'm looking forward to wearing them. These are all made in, probably in Venice. They're called Venetian beads or maybe Murano. So they're, from that area, which is famous for good, amazing beading. These are much later. These are probably 1960s. These are Murano beads. And aren't they fun? I wore them out the other day. I think I wore them with the yellow brooch. I just felt like we needed some color in this stressful time. And I posted a photo on Facebook, and everyone was quite bedazzled by these. This is bad news. This spreads, so I think you can get rid of this with vinegar water. It's called verdigris or verdigris or something like that, and it's just kind of like, I don't know, it's like a disease, a metal disease. Real gold and real silver don't get it, which is one of the appeals of real gold and real silver. So I have to clean this. I was going to mention, a lot of pieces, you know, I'm disabled and I'm in a whole heck of a lot of pain all the time. And anything hurts me. I mean, anything. And that includes the effort that I put into washing, you know, scrubbing with a toothbrush and stuff. My shoulders and neck can be sore for, you know, 48 hours afterwards. So I'm, you know, I don't clean things all the time. Fair enough, right? So anyway, that's why a lot of these pieces I'm showing you, I'm saying it needs to be cleaned, but I haven't actually done it. So this is just, you know, pretty. Let's see, I know what I'm showing you next. Ooh, you're in for a treat now. Okay. So now we're moving a little bit more towards the Art Deco period, number 3. And some beautiful pieces. I'll start with the less expensive ones first. This is just sort of, let's see, is it better this way or worse? I don't know. Your basic bar pin. It's not real. Oh, for crying out loud. I always have to hold it in your hand for you to see my hand for you to see it. There we go. It's not real, but it's pretty good quality. It's not silver, as far as I could tell. Definitely not a diamond, just glass. But it's really pretty, and I got it for, you know, nothing. Now we're moving into the Art Deco period. Very clean lines, very straight, no longer very ornate. So this would definitely not fit into Art Deco. A more modern hinge, a more modern clasp, but still sort of C-clasp-ish. And just, I don't know, just fun just to have something of the period that's in such good shape. This is of a similar style here. Much more ornate, though. There we go. This was a present from my husband for my birthday. He sort of spied on my Etsy searches and found this out. This is not real. I've shown this to you before. This is maybe actually very late Art Deco period, 1940s, because this trombone clasp is 1940s, I think. See? This again needs a cleaning. It's gold plate. I found somewhere, I can't remember where now, a marking. Yeah, it's in here. It's really, really tiny, and it's French. And it says something like plaque d'or, which is gold plate. Yeah, this is not gonna happen. Yeah, you can't. There we go. You can sort of see there's some writing there. So this is really pretty, and just again, just glass, gold plated, but you know, really nice. Now this would be your poorer person's version of that. This is none of this is real. You can tell it's the gold. The fake gold is wearing off here and there. The pearls don't have the same luminescence, or what do I call it? The colors are too uniform in these pearls. Here, let me show you. Okay, so these are real pearls. You see how they're all different, slightly different colors? And do you see how they have a sort of a pearlescence to them. They have a beautiful sort of changeable shine, whereas these really don't. They're fake. That's why. And these are real. This is paste, which is just a kind of rhinestone that was used a lot in the period. The back is a Z-clasp. And you can see the blackening. That is not silver tarnish coming through gold plate. That's just, this is just not good quality. And then a more modern clasp. So, you know, 1920, maybe 1930, something like that. Obviously, when it was first made, it would have been a lot prettier than it is here. This also was probably a lingerie pin. It is. Let's see if I can give it to you from afar. Really having trouble with focus today. There. Well, you can see how it gleams. It's gold topped. So it's a gold plate, but only on the top of it, not on the rest of it. And it looks gold. There's a few places, if you look at it very, very closely, you can see that the gold plating is wearing off around the edges. So that's a sign that it's, yeah, as you can see, especially right in there. Sign that it's not really gold. It reminds me of this one in that it also has this cute little hand etched scene in it. But this one's later. And here, if you look at it, you can see why, how I know that. It's got a much more recent hinge, as you can see, but it also has this C-clasp that you're all probably already getting used to. It is signed. I already forget who it's signed by. Move these out of the way. The blackening did not wash off. I did wash this. That's another sign that it's not real. If it were real, it would wash off. It's possible that it's tarnish coming through, but it's probable that it's just the sort of surface wearing off. So anyway, I just thought that was just so cute. It's even got a little bird flying in the sky, and it's a little cabin by the mountains, which isn't so different from where I live, although I'm right smack in the middle of a very large city. And then this, I just, oh my goodness. Okay, move my fingers out of the way. Focus. This says in Hebrew, Shaddai, or Shaddai, or something. It's kind of hard to pronounce in English. Well, that is in English. It's hard to pronounce. It's Shaddai, which is the name of God put on the mezuzot, the little diagonal things you'll see on the doorways of Jewish households. Jews aren't really supposed to utter the name of God. So instead, we use a bunch of kind of like nicknames or alternative names, and this is one of them, Shaddai. So it's, you'll see people wearing these a lot. It's just sort of, I don't know, it's just kind of a religious pin. I believe it's brass with nickel in it or something. I'm really quite sure this is 1920s, early 1920s perhaps. These roses just say very loud and clear 1920s, and I'll show you some examples of what I mean. I think it's really, really pretty. The woman who sold it really was, it's like really, really Christian and kept referring to all her Jewish stuff as messianic, which is what? But anyway, I love this. And another reason why I love this is because I got it from Scotland. It's probably not originally made in Scotland. This is pre-Holocaust European Judaica. And so much of that was destroyed by the Nazis and lost to the families who loved and cherished these pieces. So to have anything, I mean, obviously I would love to have something by my own family, but even to have anything from this period is kind of precious. And this is just really pretty. So I'm very happy with this. And let's continue with the 1930s, 1920s. Wait, let me do it this way. Boop-a-doop. When my husband and I got married, I wore rose quartz earrings, and I found these rose quartz cufflinks online for my husband. They are actually silver. The posts between them look like they're coated or something, but these themselves, which are original, are silver and they're rose quartz. And with my husband's permission, I've decided I'm going to turn them into, I'm not sure what, but something. And look what I found to go with. I have polished. These I have not. So this will polish up and match this. It's a little big for this finger, a little small for this finger. Because as I've mentioned, I'm losing weight. It's hard for me to figure out what size everything is for me. Rose quartz is not necessarily the best color for me because it matches my skin so well that it almost disappears on my skin, or I disappear in it or something. But I mean, I just think this is so pretty. I think what I'm going to do is just dangle these as an earring. So I'll have one on each ear. I can just actually, you know, this actually just unhooks. So it's really, really easy to just hook onto a shepherd's hook or something. And then I thought I might dangle another one as a pendant and, you know, just wear it just like that. And then I don't know what I'd do with the one that's left over. But I mean, the way that these match was just, and will match better when I polish the cufflinks. It was irresistible to me, and I really like this. It's, you know, I did a whole video on cocktail rings. Well, hello, cocktail ring. So I'll let you gaze upon that beauty while I find what was the, oh, I see what the next thing was that I was going to show you. It's a good thing I numbered these because I would not be keeping track otherwise. Okay. Ooh. Ah. Are angels singing yet? These are very delicate. These are made from real china. And they are impossible to find unchipped. And I think these actually are chipped. okay, we're getting too much glare here. They were sold as a set, but I don't think they're actually all made. Oh, that's better. By the same company. That some of them are signed, some of them are not. This is Royal Dalton, which I believe is a pretty reputable, very reputable jewelry company. I think that was, that's Staffordshire, so that's a different company. I'm showing these to you at the same time as the older stuff because this one, I think, is one of the older pieces. You can see by the clasp. And I thought it was just, they're so pretty. Again, they all need a bath. This one in particular, just I really, really liked, and look, it's chipped. So they need to be cleaned. They're so pretty, and they're so hard to keep in good shape. But every now and then, I can't help myself. I buy some anyway. I have some as earrings. I have some as brooches. And they're just, I mean, just this one and this one. Oh, my goodness. And so this is the same stuff you'd make teacups out of, you know, really fancy china teacups. And I mean, like, come on, how pretty is that? They're just so pretty. So I have shown you those. Those were number 4. And now we shall move on to number 5, which is the 1940s. Badoom. Not sure which ones I'll show you first. How about we start with this? Check this out, baby. This is a common style cuff from the 1940s, possibly early 1950s. I don't think it'd be much later than that. I was hoping when I saw it for sale that it might be by a company known as Crements, but I don't see it signed anywhere, and Crements did sign their pieces. Crements made most of their pieces in gold fill, which is really good quality gold plate. And by the way, I told you this was gold fill. I meant rolled gold, which is very similar to gold fill, but much earlier technique. I really like this a lot. This is actually my husband's favorite of some of the pieces I've bought recently. Oh, I just remembered I forgot to show you something, so I'll show you in a sec. Really nice. Wore this because I wanted to show you it really matches the style of this, so I thought that was fun, and I thought that they also, this one also went really well with my wedding rings. Badoop. See, so I really, really like this. I'm gonna come back to this in a second though, because I forgot to show you something super beautiful. I keep it in the plastic because I don't want the enamel to get chipped. This is probably around 1910, and I love it. Like, love, love, love. I have given it a thorough cleaning. Let's see what you see of it on this background. Oh, that looks good too. I don't even know what to say about something as pretty as this. I was so excited to find it in a price range that I could afford. It's real silver, so I was able to polish it. It was black when I got it. I'll show you what it looked like before. It's signed on the back in a couple of places by the company WBS, the company that made it. It's also signed on, yeah, you can see right there it's signed. That was Ward Brothers of Scotland. And then they made a few of these. They're selling for, you know, over $100 online, but I got this for less. And I just, oh my God. I don't even, like, again, what's there to say about it? It's gorgeous. That's just glass. This is enamel. The enamel is almost perfect except for in the tail. And I love the little floral details. Probably loop a chain through it and wear it as a necklace a lot of the time. Get poked a bit, but that's okay. Oh yeah, let's look at the back. It's got your C clasp, and it's got your slightly more modern hinge. These hinges have little flowers on them, which I've never seen before. I thought it was really cute. Don't know if you can see it though. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that, but they put little flowers on the hinges, which is a fun little detail. It's just gorgeous. Around 1910, probably. Maybe a little earlier even. And I'm just going to wear it just joyfully and constantly. I'm a bird lover. One of my other hobbies is feeding birds at my window. Okay, so getting back to the 1940s. Let's see, I have one other piece in this style. You can see that they're very similar in style. This is real silver. It's almost identical, actually. I'm looking at them. I've never looked at them side by side before with the swirls. It was a very popular style at the time. It's by a Canadian company called Bond Boyd, which made quite nice delicate. There you can see Bond Boyd, delicate sterling silver and sterling gold plated pieces that you can find for not too much money online fairly often, and I really like the femininity of the pieces. They really made some pretty stuff. I got this on the street for $5 from someone before COVID. So obviously there's kinship between these two. So that's 1940s. I wanted to show you, I wasn't sure if this was 1940s or not. I think it might be later, but it's might be, you know, 1960s or something. But I decided to show it to you at the same time because it's definitely a stylistic, whoopsie daisy, stylistic similarity between them. As you can see, the swirl, the veined flowers, etc. This is quite likely a real freshwater pearl. Not worth that much, but yeah, this is later, 1960s probably. But I wanted to show it to you. And I wanted to show you, see, this is a style, hang on, there we go, that's better. This is a style known as retro. It's 1940s as well. I got both of these pieces during COVID. They are both very much the retro style. I'm just getting into retro, so I'm having trouble describing it. It involves a lot of swirls and then sort of thick 3D components to it, which you're seeing in both of these. This one is Coro. Coro was a very reputable brand for a long time, and they made a lot of really great, you can see this is Coro, a lot of really great retro pieces. It was called retro in the 1940s. It did not mean old fashioned. That's just what they call it. I really like this one a lot. I'm really into it. It's worn a little bit here and there. Put that back there. What was really funny about this one though is that it was sold with this one literally pinned onto it right there. If you looked at the back, you could see that it was pinned onto it, that it was actually two brooches, but it was being sold as one brooch. The person selling it didn't notice that it was two brooches, which was fine by me. This one is also Coro. You can just see Coro right there. These birds sell for quite a bit of money, and since I got these two brooches as if they were one, I got a really good deal. And I really like bird jewelry. I think you've probably figured that out. I really like birds. My Hebrew name is Tzipora, which means bird. And that was a name I was able to pick for myself rather than was given to me. Because I wasn't raised Jewish. Long story, but anyway. So this is also very much in the retro style. You can see the sort of the swirly bits and the chunky bits. The 3D quality to it goes beautifully with this one, but they are not actually a single piece. So I'm really, right now, I'm really on the lookout for more retro pieces. That's like my next sort of area of research. This one I got much earlier during COVID, but I forgot to show it to you. Let me pull it back a little bit for you. I think you can see that it also is very similar in style. These are just rhinestones. I don't remember if this one is gold fill. I think it may be. Let's see, can we see this? Adorna. GF. Yeah, it says GF on it. I don't know if you can see it, but it says GF, which means it's gold fill. So there's a gold plate on top of this. I haven't washed this. I have a suspicion it will gleam more. Like, this might just be silver tarnish coming through rather than the gold plate wearing off. And therefore, it will clean up and look a lot better than it looks right now. You see again the thick 3D look. And on the back, it's a hollow. It's hollow. These are signs of 1940s. So I'm really pleased with that. These are really great retro. No, let's show it to you in white so you can see that they're gold. There you go. Silver looks bad on white and gold looks bad on green, so there's no winning. These are also Coro. Coro, you know, if you want to find some good 1940s retro style pieces, Coro is a good place to start, although you're going to pay more for Coro than something that's not signed because people know Coro. These are tiny little brooches, and you can see the Coro on the post right in there. And I just think they're the cutest little things. They would be really fun as earrings as well. If they're reminding you of the 1980s, I'm not surprised. The 1980s really did draw a lot on the 1940s, like a lot. Some of the things that can tell you that it's not 1980s is the fact that this is hollow. The 1980s ones were not hollow. See what I mean? Like that. So that's one of the things. Plus, they tend to be a little more delicate and understated. This will be great worn on two sides of the collar of a dress. I'll show you an example of what I mean. So worn kind of the same way you would wear dress clips, but they're pins. So and these were really cheap. I got these for $10 or less. I was very pleased with this purchase. Now, speaking of dress clips, it's too dark. There, that's better. They need a bath. These are actual dress clips, probably from the 1940s. I think 1940s because they have the little swirls and the bigger chunky pieces. Can you see how there's sort of a thematic kind of link between? Yeah, you can see that, right? There's the little bits, there's the little bits, there's the chunky swirls, there's the chunky swirls. You see what I mean? These were sold as Bakelite. I am not a Bakelite expert. Bakelite was a type of plastic used a lot in jewelry starting 1930s, I think, 1920s, not sure, through the 1940s especially. It's highly collectible. I've met women who are entirely addicted to Bakelite. It's pretty expensive to collect. I'm not sure if these actually are Bakelite. I did a test. You're supposed to pour hot water on them and then they smell a certain way. And I was like, I don't know. I can't tell. I have a couple of 1930s sets of bureau drawers in my bedroom that I know do have Bakelite handles. These, I'm not sure. But I'm not a huge Bakelite collector yet, so I'm fine with these. That's okay by me. Now, we just looked at number 5. Oh, and now we are going to move on to number 6, which is, oh yeah, oh wait, you're gonna this little boy. Okay, are you ready? Woohoo! Enamel, baby. Okay, let's see. Where shall we start? I showed you this. If you watched my video of a brooch bag unbagging, you saw this. This was my favorite in the bag. So you've already seen this. I just wanted to show you this because we're going to be looking at butterflies a bit here. So, from the same woman, she was selling a whole bunch of jewelry, like 60 pieces or something like this for $60. And I gotta be honest, it mostly looked like some pretty junky stuff. But, you know, I took a little time to look at the photo and I saw this in it and I plotzed, I tell you. I knew immediately this is Scandinavian silver guilloche. Very special sort of metalworking and enameling technique that is the Scandinavians were known for. It's a mid-century modern piece as well. That's when they were mostly doing it. Mid-century modern being about 1950 to about 1970. Very sort of space agey. When I got it home, I saw that it was exactly what I thought it was. It's Danish. It's by an artist named Karen Jemax or Jemax. It is sterling, as I thought, and it is definitely guilloche. I was very excited to get these. These are expensive. They're hard to find in a price range that I feel I can afford. This one was in a price range I could afford. It balanced out to being something like $6 because I got so many other pieces with it. And it's stunning. This is a piece I inherited some from my grandmother. This is another example of Scandinavian guilloche, mid-century modern. I think you can see they're very similar. They do metalwork, kind of metal turning. I don't understand how it works. On the middle, and then they put this enamel on top. So you can see a similarity. Also silver, Norway, etc., etc. This one's an older one. It has a C clasp. This one is newer, but they're very much of the same style. So I'm really excited about this. Now, some of you may be asking, didn't you say in one of your last videos that you don't wear light blue, that light blue really is an upsetting color for you, that you associate all kinds of horrible things that bad people did to you with this color? Yes, 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 and yes. But after I made that video, I felt like I was kind of letting my abuse history deprive me of certain kinds of beauty. And when I saw this, I thought, I'm going to kind of therapize myself. I'm going to try to make this blue my color again, not the color that the bad guys ruined for me. Ooh. Look how beautiful it looks on the white. So this is kind of like aversion therapy, but in a pretty way. I will wear this, definitely. I'd like to wear it with sunny yellow. So I'm really, really excited about that. While we were at it, I wanted to show you, this is fake guilloche. I bought it though anyway, because I love it. I honestly can't even explain to you why this is fake and this is real, except for that I know for sure that it is. One of the things that makes me know is the back. This is artisanally made. This is not. This is cheap, light metal. This is heavy silver. This has, the bar is just a component piece just glued on. This is made right into the piece. The antennae are on their own. This is just sort of a stamped piece. The colors here are just sort of painted on. They don't actually sort of go with... I'm stopping because I honestly can't explain a whole lot more than that. But I loved this and I got it anyway because it matched these. And it's an imitation of these. And it's beautiful. I really, really like it. This came with it. I don't know what the hell it's supposed to be. A mushroom? I don't know. It's pretty. I don't understand how it works. Again, it's fake-ish. This one I think is better quality than this, though. This I think is actual real cloisonné. So that was nice. And then while I'm at it, now this is super fake. You can see it's just painted on. There's no texturing in the metal at all. I got it at the same time that I got this piece. But I like it, and I'll definitely wear it. It's pretty. It's fairly modern. Nothing fancy, but I like it. And then again, I thought this was a nice time to show you this amazing butterfly that I got not too long ago. This one is quite recent, maybe even made in the 2000s. And it all started with this. Oh, yeah, so pretty. I forget what number I'm on now. Oh, I know. Oh, we're making good time, folks. Making good time here. We are now moving on to the 1970s. This was a splurge, and I might have paid too much for it, but I don't really care. This is C for my name. It was over $100. It is gold. I just like it. I think that it matches my rings. I really like pieces with vines on them. Wait. I just think they're very, I don't know, very pretty, very organic. You can tell this is a much lower carat. This is 18. This is not slower. I can't remember what it is, like 10 carat or something. Anyway, so I got this. I think this was made in the 1970s. At least that's what the seller believed. The person selling it said it was 1970s. I'm really not sure. I'm trying to show you the gold color. It's not working out, but. Anyway, so I know I'm going to wear this a lot. I kind of get a kick out of stuff with names on it and something and stuff. I'm not sure why. I also like this too because it's a serif font. I'm into fonts. I'm kind of a writer, and sans serif bugs me. It's too modern. I don't find it elegant enough. So it's a serif font. So I got it. This is a very cheaply made Avon ring. Really nothing special at all. Very lightweight, plastic, adjustable, which is nice. Signed Avon. Probably from the 70s or maybe early 80s. But the reason I got it is because it matches these. And these are very, very, very special to me. I think I might have, yeah. I designed both of these. Sometime I'll probably do a post, a video just about these. I designed both of these, they're real, to memorialize the deaths of my two cats. This is Morgan's pendant. Morgan lived to 20 years old. I got him when I was 20. He lived until I was 40. And this is Bobby's pendant. Bobby lived to 21 years old, and he died. I got him when I was 26, I think. So he only died recently. They're onyx and gold, diamond. I made the bales at the top to match. That is sphorite garnet. And obviously this is much lower quality, but you can see how lovely it'll look with these when I wear them together. So let me bring them up to you so you can see them. I designed each of these pendants. They were both black cats, and I designed each of these pendants to match their personalities. Sometime I'll explain it all to you. There, you can get a better sense of them now. So, thus this. And I actually have the matching pendant as well, but I don't think I'll wear it very often because I have these, so why would I? I also have the matching earrings to this that I found before COVID. So that was pretty, really, really special for me to have those. Do you suppose I can get this ring on my fingers too? There we go. And now let's move on to some 1970s stuff. Kerthunk. Let's start with this piece. This one, I paid very little for. I tested to see if it was silver, and it said it wasn't, but I'm now thinking that it actually is probably just not a 925 silver. It's a lower quality silver. Quite old, as you can see. So actually probably not 1970s. I wasn't quite sure where to put these in my series. This tests as a real stone, not just glass or enamel. But I don't know what kind. The tester can't tell me what kind, so I'm really not sure. This is not my usual style. It's a little bit too hippie-ish for me, but the reason I got it was because it matches this. And this belonged to my great aunt Dorothy. She lived to 97 years old. She, like me, was a great jewelry lover. And I got her costume jewelry when she passed. And it's very precious to me. So I just couldn't resist. This was a very low price. And I couldn't resist. I don't know, you know, this doesn't tell me anything about who made it or where it was made. It's hollow. So is this. This is Jerusalem. This is Israeli. Has 950 silver, so that's higher quality silver. You can see where I didn't polish it and where I did. It says, oh look, I never noticed it's stamped there. That might be something about the maker. You can wear it as a pendant or as a brooch. This one is made later maybe than this one, I don't know. I'm wondering if this one is also Israeli because they're so similar. This is called Eliat stone. I think that's how you pronounce it. I believe it's the stone of Israel. I know very little about it though. So you can see why I saw this and it was a really low price and I just thought I have to have it. I mean, for that price and yeah, I mean, hello. So I got it. I have a few rings on now. Let's see. Yeah, you can see the color in that fairly well. I got this because I had this already. That's basically the whole story. I really like them. For some reason, my husband doesn't. I don't know why. I think he doesn't like, these are called unfoiled. They have, they're open in the back so you can sort of see things through them. And for some reason, he doesn't really like that. I don't know why. I think they're really lovely. This again needs a bit of a bath. You can see it's sort of dirty around the edges. These colors were really popular in the 1970s. I just like them. I think I like the greens. I like the unfoiled. I like that you can see through them. So they're sort of, I don't know, you can see what you're wearing underneath them a little bit. I assume they're made by the same maker. If you watched my jewelry unbagging, you saw that I got this as well. At that time, I mentioned that I had these two, but I didn't really show them to you, so I thought I'd just show them to you all together now. At some point, I might wear them all three at once. It might be a little bit much. I don't know. So, yeah, those are really, really nice. Along the same vein, just when COVID was starting, I got this beauty. I really like this. This is totally mid-century modern style, you know, kind of space agey, very geometric. I'm thinking 1960s, early 1970s, something like that. I mean, I love it. I really, really love it. And it's a bit different from some of the other stuff I wear, which is maybe a little more sort of flowery and feminine. That's not all that I am. There's no maker's mark on the back, so I don't know who made it, but it's definitely very, very well made. If you know, let me know. I've never seen it before. I love it. I love, love, love it. It's just very, oh, I don't know, hip. It's kind of Barnaby Jones. I've been telling you, I've been watching Barnaby Jones a lot lately. Let's see. Okay, so while we're talking about the 1960s, this one came in a big collection along with, where did it go? Oh yeah, the collection that I bought for this had this in it. It's missing some of the little faux pearls and stuff. So again, these are faux seed pearls. We were talking about that earlier. Turquoise and gold was really popular in the 60s and early 70s. So is this intensely textured gold look, kind of rough textured. I'm not in love with this, but it came with the collection, and I like it, and I will wear it if I'm doing a kind of a 1960s look. So that was fun. This was also one of the ones that was in the batch that was with this, and it's one of the pieces that made it worth buying. It was worth buying even just for the one brooch. I knew that I was going to like this, not love, but certainly like it enough to wear it sometimes. And when I got it, I found that it was made by an extremely reputable company known as Weiss, as you can see right there. Weiss, I don't know. This is probably, again, probably 1970s. Their crystals tend to keep their beauty not turn yellow or dark. This again needs a bath. When it has a bath, it's going to gleam a lot better than it is now. It's got the texturing that was so popular at the time. I like it. I'll definitely wear it. I don't know what the hell they're supposed to be. Chestnuts or something? I don't know. Tell me. I thought while we're at it, I'd show you this one because it's so similar. This is by, I forget. Oh, there it is. BSK. Don't know much about that company. I think it's a bit later. This was in a brooch bag or a jewelry jar that my husband got me for my birthday, and they go really perfectly together. Who knows, I might actually wear them together at some point. Not like, oh my god, I love it so much, but, you know, I'll wear it for sure. So that was really cool. I got this. Let's focus. Set. The woman was actually selling these earrings were part of an earring batch, and this brooch was part of a brooch batch, and I noticed that they matched, so I asked her if she'd sell them just on their own like this, and she said sure, and I think I paid $15, which is really good. It's, I don't know if it's exactly my style. It's definitely not my style. I'm sure I'll wear these. I just think it's kind of sweet. Probably 1970s. Nice, you know? This lined texturing. Is that also BSK? Let's see. The lined texturing is a sign that it's 1970s or later. Oh, come on, you can focus better than that. Well, I can't read that, can you? Oh my god, no way. Let's see, is it signed on here? I don't think these are even signed. I don't know. If I see it, I'll let you know. So these were fun. I like these. This is, you know, I'm not as passionate about these as like my Victorian pieces or something, but I definitely like them a lot. I like them a lot. Again, in the same brooch bag with the enamel, the beautiful Norwegian enamel, or was it Danish? I forget. This really needs a bath, but it's Coro. I forget. Yeah, it's signed. You can see it signed in there. There, Coro. Coro is pretty good quality. This is tiny. This is what would be known as a scatter pin. You're supposed to wear a bunch of them together. It'll clean up nicely, and it's cute. And it was part of this batch. While we're on cute, these were also both part of that batch. And I do like birds. I don't know if I'll wear this one. I might give it to some kids in the neighborhood. I believe they're both, yeah, I think it's enamel on copper. It has a sort of, I can't describe the effect, but I can recognize it. I like this one. It's nice. I'll probably wear this one. There was another, oh yeah, and in the same batch, there was this one here. I've seen these often sold as Art Deco. They're not, don't let someone fool you. It's extremely lightweight plastic. This one, I don't know if it needs a bath or it's just discolored or what, so it's not as nice as some of the other ones I've seen, but you know, it's fine. I can definitely see myself wearing it with certain things. Now we're moving, we're almost done. Moving forward to really close to the present day now. We've got some things that just kind of came with larger collections. Hang on. This, I don't think I'll even keep this or wear this, but there's someone in my neighborhood that has this kind of dog. I think her name is, or what is her name? I forget, but it's been so long since I've seen my neighbors, but every time I call her, she comes running up. She wiggles and wiggles and wiggles, and she's so excited to see me, and I'm just going to give this to them. I don't know if they'll even want it, but I just made me think of them. I can feel her little body wriggling in my hands as I look at this. So I'll give that to them. This is just cheap plastic, but I actually like it. I think it's quite beautiful. It more than a little bit resembles the female anatomy, and I think that honoring the female anatomy every chance we get is definitely a good thing to do. So I'll definitely wear this. Very lightweight, so I could wear it on the thinnest of fabrics without it pulling it down in any way. So that's nice. These came in the set of that had this in it. They're quite cheaply made. They're very, very recently made, you know, within the last... They're definitely not earlier than the 90s. I'd say they're later than the 90s. But they're really fun, and I'll wear them together, and it's fun to have a set. This also came with that. It's more cheaply made than it looks, which is why I know I will wear it, because it looks better quality than it is. It's very lightweight. It does have a C-clasp, though, so I'm curious about when it was made. It's obviously modeled on much older styles, and I actually like it. It's tiny. I don't know when and where I'll wear it, but I think it looks much better quality than it really is. So, and then if you remember in a previous video, I got some of these, and look, I just got some more of my little cuddling panda bear. So come on, focus. There. So, now I've got 4 cuddling panda bears. I don't know where the other brooch is, but that's fun. So that's pretty much everything. I'm trying to think which pieces I'm the very most excited about in the stuff that I've gotten recently. I would say this one. Let's see. This one. So I'm a lot of the really older ones. This one, and this one, let's see, what else? I know there were a few others that I was really, really excited about too. This one. And I think come on, don't be shy, little birdie. This one, I'd say these are the ones I'm most excited about, and some of them were splurges. I mean, they are pretty good quality here. Victorian, Edwardian, so these are all really early, maybe 1920s, and then not sure, 1960s maybe. These are my favorites, and they are, this was a bit of a splurge, meaning 60 or 70, yeah, all of these were in that range, so that's quite a bit of money, but this was an incredible steal, so kind of balances out. Oh, and I'm really fond of this, too. Okay. So, those are some of my latest acquisitions. My entertainment budget during COVID is beauty. And I hope you enjoyed them, too. The vaccine is here, but we still got We still got a long haul, so let's enjoy beauty while we're all stuck at home. Okay. Salut, my chickadees.